Check, check. Check, check, check.
Thank you. There's Walter. Oh, here. Well, I would like to welcome you all here on behalf of the Wilson Center. My name is Paulo Sotero. I'm the director of the Brazil Institute here at the center. I welcome you on behalf of three programs, the Brazil Institute, the Environmental Change and Security Program, and the Latin American Program here represented by Cindy Arson. We run these types of programs under a series called Managing Our Planet. There is an explanation about the series started 5 years ago thanks to the guidance, idea brought to us by our chief guru, Ms. Tom Lovejoy, a member of our advisory board and a dear friend. It is a great, great honor for the Wilson Center to welcome our colleagues from the World Resources Institute, Walter Vergara, Luciana Gallardo Lomeli, and Alan Mountford. We are particularly honored to have with us this morning Sean DeWitt from the World Resources Institute, Lester Brown, President Emeritus and founder of the Earth Policy Institute, and Paola Agostini, director or from the Environmental and Natural Resources area of the World Bank, and obviously our own Tom Lovejoy. I just wanted now to call Helen Mountford to the podium. You have biographies of everybody in this page. Helen will decide whether to summarize them for you. So the topic is absolutely crucial, the economic case for landscape restoration in Latin America. Latin America will respond to the added demand for food in the planet as the population grows from current 7 billion to plus 9 billion plus over the next 35 years. And this is a major challenge because Latin America will have to do this while preserving its natural assets. And I don't think it was done in the world before, but it will have to find a way of doing this. Obviously, our interest as Brazil Institute is because Brazil is central to this exercise. With that, I would like to pass the floor to Helen. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Paolo, and thank you very much for generously hosting the important launch of this report here today at the Wilson Center. We're really pleased to be able to be here and join you and have everybody with us to discuss this report and the work that's going on. Currently, over one quarter of the world's agricultural lands are categorized as severely degraded. Not lightly degraded, not partially degraded, but severely degraded. That means that those lands are not producing the crops that they could. It means that the farmers and the rural communities are not benefiting from the incomes that they could if these lands were productive. And it means that we are suffering food insecurity in countries and regions as a result. And of course, it's also contributing to greenhouse gas emissions and to further degradation of valuable ecosystem services. This is a huge problem. And it's why at the New Climate Economy, the flagship project of a global commission on the economy and climate that's led by former president of Mexico, Felipe Calderon, that's why the New Climate Economy has highlighted that restoration of degraded agricultural lands and forest lands is a major opportunity, not only for the climate, but also for growth and for poverty reduction. We stress that the degradation of productive landscapes costs round about $100 billion per year globally. That's the loss we have from degradation of protective landscapes. And according to some estimates, as much as 12% of the world's degraded lands were brought back into production, productive activity, we could feed another 200 million people worldwide, and farmer incomes could be raised by about $40 billion per year. There's been some exciting and very innovative examples of successful restoration around the world. And we cite a number of examples from China's lowest plateau, where the World Bank, together with the Chinese government, helped to restore large areas of land, to Niger. Both of these were examples where we saw significantly enhanced crop yields and farmers lifted out of poverty. In China, the estimate is that as much as 2.5 billion people were lifted out of poverty thanks to the restoration activities. And in Niger, over 1 million households saw double their farmer income as what they had before as a result. So real opportunity for social progress and development. And this new report by colleagues at the World Resources Institute, by Walter Vergara, by Luciana, and by others, and was developed in close partnership with the Inter-American Center for Tax Administration, the CIAT, and CATI, the Tropical Agricultural Research and Higher Education Center, and the Inter-American Development Bank. It was really a sort of collective effort, and it continues to build this important evidence base of the economic benefits of restoring degraded lands, this time providing evidence from Latin America, a region which, as Paula mentioned, is absolutely essential as we go forward, both for growth and development and also for climate action. The report answers the question of why public and private actors should be interested in restoration in Latin America, and it's used a very innovative approach to quantify some of the benefits of restoration, including some which we've had difficulty capturing before, for example, around food security, some of those benefits. It's a first cut at pulling these numbers together, but of course there's many more benefits that aren't yet able to be quantified and captured here. Even without these, as Walter will tell us in a few moments, the net benefits of investing in restoration in Latin America, according to the report, are very, very clear. It's still beneficial, even without being able to quantify all the benefits. The report is a first effort, and one that has been undertaken with this broad partnership, but we also want to invite all of you here today and others to help to continue to build on these results and this approach, to further refine the answers and the analysis for the future. We need this evidence base, and we need to be able to translate it into valuable efforts for investors, so that investors will actually come to the table and inspire the investments that are needed to make this restoration happen at a large scale. And Walter will share some of the exciting news and developments that we're seeing already in Latin America in this regards. But let me stop now and pass over to my colleague, Walter Vergara, to tell you more about the results of the report. Now, Walter needs no introduction, and I certainly won't introduce everyone here, but I do want to say a few words about Walter. Many of you will know him as a senior fellow at the World Resources Institute, and previously a leading figure on climate in both IDB and the World Bank. But over the last couple of years, Walter has also led this exciting initiative, 20 by 20, which ambitiously aimed to get 20 million hectares of land in Latin America and Caribbean region committed into restoration by 2020. And already, in just 2 years, he's already convinced 11 countries to come to the table and commit over 26 million hectares, so already attracting, doing more than what had initially been the ambition, and has attracted over $1 billion in investments from impact investors and others. So it's an impressive feat. We're starting to see the results of work like this report, but we need to accelerate it further in future if we're to get the success we need in restoring degraded lands, enhancing farmer income and better growth. So let me pass now to Walter to share some of the exciting results from this report with us. Thank you.
Good morning to all. I'm very pleased to be here. I want, first of all, to thank Paolo for hosting us. It's great to be associated with the Wilson Center. I want to thank my colleagues. I want to recognize my colleagues because I get to make a presentation, but as Helen said, this is a team effort, a large team effort, and also involving a number of institutions. So I want again to point out that my colleagues, Luciana from WRI, Ana Rios, I don't know if she's here, from IDB, Paul Isbell, who's in Madrid, probably listening to us right now, Stephen Prager from SIAT, and Ron Camino from CATIE were part of the team that prepared this report. But I also need to recognize the tremendous effort in reviewing the report and publishing the report by a large team. And I want to highlight two names. Michael Verdon, who was at IUCN, who was a fantastic peer reviewer and gave us a number of suggestions, dicas, on how to proceed. And I want to send a salute to James Anderson, our communications lead at WRI, who has made a tremendous effort to produce this out. I've written many reports, but I'm impressed by how WRI puts it together in record time. So the bottom line here is, if you want to produce a new report, think about the WRI logo. Okay, so let's start. As Helen said, the objective here is to answer one question. Why should private and public actors invest in restoration in Latin America? It's a simple question, but we put it inside the wraps of the 20 by 20 program, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. What are the net benefits of a 20 million hectare landscape restoration program with the nature and scope of 20 by 20? So that's the single objective. Now, a little bit of context quickly. As Helen said, I've worked many, many years on climate change. Why am I interested in restoration? Well, this is the answer. For Latin America, land use and land use change are the key drivers for greenhouse gas emissions. 56% of all emissions in the region come from land use and land use change. This is completely different to the United States, to Europe, to Asia, to Australia, to Canada. This is unique to Latin America. So this is one reason why we should focus on land use, the climate perspective, but also the social perspective. 50% of all employment outside large metropolitan areas is directly or indirectly linked to agriculture and forestry activities in Latin America, so it's a major job-generating sector. And as Paulo said a minute ago, Latin America is being called increasingly so to fill in the gap between supply and demand for food. This figure was 11% just 10 years ago. Now 13% of the total global food, feed, and fiber trade comes from Latin America. And as time proceeds, we would expect Latin America to continue to increase its share of food production in the global trade of food and fiber. Now, on the other side, and you see here the dichotomy, since 2000, 37 million hectares of our forests, of our savannas, of our mangroves have been plowed in to make room for additional agricultural production. This is clearly unsustainable. We cannot every 10 years destroy or change almost 40 million hectares of land. And to point that out more clearly, in 2014, the last year where we have an accurate number, 3.4 million hectares of land were forest land were cleared. This is equivalent to 70% of the land area of Costa Rica. Imagine that. Imagine all the birds and the trees and the butterflies and all the life around forests that is gone every year because of this change. And on top of that, we now have a negative asset. We are accumulating a lot of degraded land that is underproductive or non-productive at all. According to Potapov, about 350 million hectares of land. So that's the context for the study. What are the impacts of land degradation? They are very clear. I won't spend a lot of time through it. Let's run through it. Affects production capacity. You know, you can imagine unproductive land not delivering the food or the ecosystem services that are required. It contributes to the loss of ecosystem services and biodiversity. It reduces resilience to climate impacts, to extreme weather events. Unproductive land will contribute to the drainage of soil, to the affectation of water reservoirs and so forth, and also the latent heat that falls on uncovered land without vegetation, will just increase the temperature of the soil instead of being captured to generate biomass. It increases the carbon footprint of the region, and very importantly, it affects the welfare of rural populations in the region. So what are the restoration approaches that we are thinking about in Latin America? And when I say we is the collective we. These are the nations that are defining what is restoration. This is not a WRI or a think tank elsewhere or in Europe designing or defining restoration. This is the collective wisdom of the countries in Latin America. They define restoration as silvopasture, or the conversion of cattle ranch, degraded cattle ranch, into a mixture of forest and pastures, agroforestry, a blend of forest and crops, low-carbon sustainable agriculture, reforestation, and assisted regeneration. So this is the milieu of reforestation approaches being considered today in Latin America. Restoration, on the other hand, if we are successful in restoring the functionality of land, has a number of benefits. Potential benefits include improving the productivity along with soil and water retention, increase the vegetation cover, and therefore the carbon stocks, bringing back lost biodiversity, improving ecosystem services, providing additional economic services like ecotourism, and improving food security in rural areas. So this is 20 by 20. This is a very quick plug on it. This is a collective program led by the countries in the region, defined by the program countries in the region. They collectively have declared that they would like to restore start the process of restoration by 2020 of about 20 million hectares of land. In fact, as Helen said, we are at 27 and we'll probably pass that before COP. And an important indication of the answer to the question, why should private sector invest? 20 by 20 is already associated with a pledge by private sector to provide over $1 billion in risk, in capital equity, in risk capital. So that gives you an indication that clearly there is something here that supports the restoration process in the eyes of the private sector. So for this study, we've made a number of assumptions. It's a macro study, it's a composite assignment. And we have to simplify it, and these are the assumptions, the key assumptions that were included. to some of our economic colleagues, we've taken a diversion. We said we will not consider willingness to pay. And that is basically because we are not going to put a price on biodiversity defined by a local population. Let's think about the blue arara, the blue parrot in Brazil. The genetic information of that parrot is huge. And what scientists think at the University of Sao Paulo about the value of the blue arara is much higher than what the farmers around the blue arara think the parrot is worth. So we have excluded that until we get better estimates. We have also selected to use long rotation periods for forestry production. So we are not talking about teca, we're not talking about eucalyptus, we're thinking about tropical species or native species with long rotation periods. This has the effect of dampening the revenues from timber operations, but we thought that was the right thing to do. We are including ecotourists based on the extensive information that has been collected in Costa Rica. We are including the avoided cost of insurance premiums, because now, thanks to IMF, I think there is someone from IMF here, yes, we have now information on the level and the scope of foreign insurance premiums and how they can be reduced by increasing food security. And we have included evaluation of carbon stocks at a very low cost, a very low value, $5 per ton, which is at the bottom of any estimate, with various recorded stock rates and a discount rate of 3%. Now, biome distribution, degree of degradation, we have to make assumptions. These are based on studies by a number of people at WRI and other outfits. We've used these numbers, basically severe degradation in Latin America, already at 8%, for example. And we have a distribution of what restoration methods we're going to use. This is an assumption, this is an approximation. Now, how did we monetize the net benefits? So we use the net present value of the 20 by 20 program, assuming it is successful over a long period of time. These are the added benefits that it will deliver. We discount the net present value of the business as usual scenario. That's the NPV definition. And we are including this set of benefits. And they are non-traditional in some sense. Value of wood forest products with long rotation periods, non-food forest products, ecotourism revenue, a net increase in agricultural production, which is associated with agroforestry or silvopasture activities, avoided costs of food security, and the value of carbon sequestration. So these are the results. We get a composite internal rate of return of 8.75. It's good. This is the composition of the return of the revenues. You see that in the pie chart. You can see carbon, even at that low value, is a significant fraction. The most important outcome is in gains in agricultural production through landscape management schemes, non-wood forest products, wood forest products, and income from ecotourism make up for the balance, as well as avoided food security costs. Now, in terms of the values, we came out with a composite number of, taking into account all the assumptions that we've made, of about $1,100 per hectare. Net present value, of which is the difference between all the benefits, discounting all the costs, including all the costs for restoration, and that's the distribution that I reported in the pie chart before. But the report includes our NPV results that you can consult. If we focus all the restoration activities in wet biomes, the NPV increases by about 50%. If it is only dry biomes, decreases by about 50%. And if we work only in dry, severely degraded lands, the business is tough. That's one of the messages of the report. Now, an additional important dimension of restoration work is the climate dimension. And we've made an estimate using numbers in the literature of what a program of this nature and scope will represent in terms of carbon storage, and these are the numbers. 1.3 gigatons, that's one quarter of the annual footprint of Latin America. An annual storage rates of about 50 million tons of carbon during the initial 20 years. Now, we had to make some assumptions. And two of the assumptions that are very critical here are the discount rate and the value of carbon. So if you look at this table, you see the variability induced by these two factors. If we keep the discount rate at 3%, but increase the value of carbon to $20, which is not out of the realm of possibilities, the net present value almost doubles, triples. But if we increase the discount rate to 10% and we keep the price of carbon at $5, is almost a washout situation. So that gives you a good image of the great influence of these factors in the net present value. Now, in conclusions, because today what we want is a discussion with Tom, Lester, Paula. So let's go very quickly through the conclusions. This is a composite, this report presents a composite macro picture. This doesn't answer the internal rate of return of a project by Terra Vela in Costa Rica. It's not the intention. Good morning. The intention is to have a macro picture. Is this a good business overall? And the answer is yes. It has a good net present value, has a good rate of return for this type of activities in a composite manner. The other message is there is a large restoration potential in the region. We have 350 million hectares to work with. This is a tremendous asset of undervalued natural capital that we can recover with so many benefits for society, for investors, for the state, for rural populations. So it is a good business, but we've made this assessment using very conservative assumptions. And we have ignored a number of substantial but difficult to quantify co-benefits. Restoration, finally, is a key action for the climate dimension in Latin America. Restoration has to be at the center of any climate change program in Latin America. Now, that's 10 minutes, but Helen asked me to present a little bit about the financial architecture of 20 by 20, so I will exceed my presentation by 1 minute. This is basically what is behind 20 by 20 in terms of financials. We have a risk capital pool, which now sits at $1.1 billion. This is pledged capital available for investments in restoration by the private sector. We hope this number will increase by early next year. I'm confident it will be somewhat higher. We are about to announce a deal on working capital for $50 million, and that means one institution, one private sector institution, will provide working capital to these investments. And this is very important because investments in restoration in rural areas many instances have a number of years ahead of them without revenues. We are working on an investment readiness fund that will work on a continuing grant basis to provide the resources to prepare projects for all these folks that are investing their capital. We already have a partial risk guarantee approved by the Global Environment Facility through IDB, and we are working on strengthening that risk guarantee with additional proposals, including to the Green Climate Fund. And we have a healthy, very good association with debt financing, including with our friends from the World Bank, CAF, and IDB. So that's what I have to tell you. At this moment, I would like to pass the voice to Sean and the important part of this meeting, which is talking to our colleagues in the panel. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Sean DeWitt. I'm the director of the Global Restoration Initiative at the World Resources Institute. And even though I'm a little bit under the weather today, and my apologies for my the sound of my voice, I was thinking this morning how lucky I am and how I have probably the best job in the world. And there's two reasons for that. One is that first I get to moderate this amazing panel with three of the people I admire the most from the environmental sector, so really excited about that. But also, every day I get to go to work and think about how we can be the first generation, perhaps in human history, to leave the planet better than we found it. And there's something really profound about that for me with restoration. I know this is not easy, of course. This is very difficult to do. The problems are very distributed in nature. But the potential of restoration, I think, is just is really exciting and really empowering. And so I look forward to this discussion as we talk about how this can become a reality. So the panel we have today, the title of the panel is The Role and Relevance of Land Restoration for Climate, for Natural Capital, and for Rural Welfare. Each of which being really equally important. I would like to now, with a few introductory remarks. So my job here is to make sure we have a lively discussion. I do want to note that we had to change the timing of the meeting a bit, and so Tom, unfortunately, will have to leave us at around 12 p.m. So what we'll do at that time, I'll ask Walter to join us back on stage as well as a special guest. And if there are specific questions about the report, maybe more detailed questions about the report, perhaps you could save your questions until then and we could address those questions at that time. With that, I would love to introduce our esteemed panelists. And as I call your name, if you could come up and please take your seats. First is Dr. Tom Lovejoy. Tom is a professor in the Department of Environmental Science and Policy at the George Mason University, also a senior fellow for Science, Economics, and the Environment at the United Nations Foundation. Tom has been rightfully and appropriately termed the godfather of biodiversity. He's really put biodiversity on the agenda for many decades. He's worked under the Reagan, the Bush, and the Clinton administrations. He was also the World Bank's chief biodiversity advisor and lead specialist for environment for Latin America and the Caribbean. Tom, thank you for all you've done and welcome.
Thank you.
Next, if I could introduce Mr. Lester Brown. Lester is an environmental analyst. He's the founder of the World Watch Institute back in 1974. And I think, largely because of this, a college newspaper once referred to Lester as the environmental Paul Revere, which I thought was very appropriate as well, really signaling the early call for us to take these environmental concerns very, very seriously. As a founder of the World Watch Institute and the founder, up until his retirement of the Earth Policy Institute just a couple of years ago, which was a nonprofit research organization based in DC, Lester has authored or co-authored more than 50 books. an incredible contribution, the latest being the great transition, shifting from fossil fuels to solar and wind energy back in 2015. And previous to that was Full Planet, Empty Plates, the new geopolitics of food scarcity, which I think shows you the wide diversity in topics that Lester has really brought to humanity's attention. So Lester, thank you for joining us, and thank you for all you've done over the years. It's a pleasure. And lastly, if I can introduce Dr. Paola Agostini. Paola is a lead environmental economist in the World Bank's Environment and Natural Resource Practice. She is the global lead for resilient landscapes as well as forestry at the World Bank, some really important really important roles. She holds a PhD in economics from the University of California, San Diego, and a Master of Arts from the University of Bocconi in Milan, Italy, and is one of the most collaborative people that I've ever worked with. And Paola, thank you so much for being with us here today. You're welcome. So in diving in, and the way we'd like to do this, I'll float a few questions. We'll take about 20 minutes or so, and then we'd love to turn it over to folks in the audience for some of your questions as well. But if I could, Tom, if I could ask a first question. You've heard from Walter that, you know, the findings of this macroeconomic study for Latin America. How do you see this study perhaps influencing policymaking or investment in the region?
So what I find really exciting about this report is that it actually takes us in first major steps of a direction that the whole world needs to actually take. Basically, we can't get where we need to get on climate without involving the land and forests in particular. So having this very sort of concrete example worked out in Latin America actually begins to show how you can actually go about this. And the fact that it has already attracted a surprising number so quickly in terms of support, insufficient, of course, but a great beginning, says that it is actually resonating with the economic sector.
Great. Thank you, Tom. Paola, if I could jump to you with the same question. You know, Tom mentioned great start. It's been moving quite quickly. What are your thoughts? How do you see this study influencing operations in the region?
Well, thank you very much, Sean. I'm actually really very honored to be here in this panel. So first of all, I would like to say that there was a lot of expectation about these reports. I knew it was coming, and at the World Bank, I was getting a lot of requests. So what are the results? What is happening? So I can't wait that the embargo is over to get back to them with that. And it's really, really awaited, not only from my colleagues of the bank, but from the partners and from the countries. I think after I looked at it now that this book is going to be really a what we call in the bank a game changer in terms of allowing to do a lot more in justifying a lot more investment in landscape restorations, and it will greatly help the practitioner, the politicians, the governments to really invest in that. So let me start with that. What I want to say is that how do I see it? You know, in the bank we do a lot of work on the wealth accounting right now. Mm-hmm. It's one of the major line of the business of our environment and natural resource global practice. And everywhere in the world, and Latin America is not exception, we are looking at the wealth as the sum of four factors: the physical capital, the human capital, the natural resource capital, and the financial capital. Almost everywhere, the depletion of a natural natural capital is really impacting a lot the wealth of a nation. And we are talking about wealth, we are not talking about GDP, because wealth is much broader than GDP. So why we are interested in this kind of report is because this will allow us to justify investing more in reversing the depletion of this natural capital for poverty on the one hand, but for growth on the other hand, and for a sustainable growth. we have a lot of work on landscape restoration already going on, which I hope that with this report we can even increase, and I'm going to talk about it later. Let me leave for to that for now.
Great. Thank you, Paula. Lester, same question to you. You heard Walter explain some of the details of the study. I'm curious, and you've seen a lot. You've written a lot of books. You've written a lot of articles. You've written a lot of studies. How do you think this study may influence policy and practice in the region?
I have not read the study. I confess. I mean, I've looked at it, and I have a feel for it. One of the things that I am working on now is a book on the world water situation. Mm-hmm. And so water becomes, I mean, an obviously important part of the resource base. Mm-hmm. Without water, our life expectancy drops to 4 days. So we have a situation where the Academy of Sciences has pointed out that 40% that we're looking at a 40% water shortfall worldwide by 2030. The National Academy of Sciences also looked at the 37 largest aquifers in the world. Of those, 21 are shrinking, 13 are shrinking at a disturbingly rapid rate. Even as the water resources, accessible water resources, are shrinking, we're adding 81 million people each year. I've looked at some aquifers, some of the world's key aquifers, and I've looked particularly at the rate of pumping and the rate of recharge. And this table is the scariest table that I have ever seen. I'll just take seven of the largest aquifers in the world and give you the numbers. The Arabian Peninsula is pumping 5 times as fast as the aquifers recharge. California Central Valley, twice as fast, 2 to 1. And this is one of the richest agricultural areas in the world, but it's overpumping by 2 to 1. China, parts of the Yellow River Basin, also overpumping 2 to 1. Northwest India, some of the, probably the fastest aquifer depletion in the world. The Indus Aquifer, which provides food for 300 million people, is being overpumped by 15 to 1. This is an aquifer whose life expectancy is not measured in decades, it's more like years. 300 million people depend on that water that won't be there not too many years down the road. The Saudi Arabia aquifer is being overpumped 10 to 1. The U.S. High Plains aquifer, this is the aquifer that stretches from Nebraska down through North Texas and Oklahoma. A huge part of the U.S. Agricultural land area. It produces at least 30% of U.S. agricultural output. It's being overpumped by 12 to 1. 12 gallons of water pumped for every gallon of recharge. You don't have to be a mathematician to see where that is taking us. So we're, and in Yemen as a country, Yemen already one of the most unstable areas in the world politically, is overpumping at the national level by 5 to 1. So the water issue is, I think, I mean, someone asked the question, which is more imminent, climate change or water scarcity? I think it's water scarcity. It's here now, and it's measurably affecting people. The Arab countries have seen their grain production drop by something like 23% over the last 6 years because of aquifer depletion. They just don't have the water anymore. So that's the main point that I would start with. is looking at the water issue. And again, this is not something, you know, we're looking at decades down the road. It's here now. And we're already seeing grain production begin to drop in a number of countries. Worldwide, there has been no growth in the grain harvest for the last 4 years. The grain harvest, which has been growing since the middle of the last century, has now plateaued. And the question is this plateauing going to remain a plateau, or is this a transition to a decline in the world grain harvest as a result of spreading water scarcity? So this is sort of my introduction to the, I can go on and talk for a while, but just to set the stage and get the water issue on the table, because I think it is the issue that's going to hit us first among the various environmental resources we're concerned with. I think water is the one that where the effect is imminent.
Great, thank you, Lester. And I want to come back and talk a bit about the role that restoration may be able to play in helping to limit or treat some of those. But cognizant of time, Tom, I want to turn to you before you have to run. As a godfather of biodiversity, curious to get your thoughts on some of the linkages that you see between restoration and biodiversity. And also, just given that the study was really focused on the economic case, do you think that some of the biodiversity conservation and recovery can be monetized to influence some of the investment decisions by the private sector?
So let me say a little bit about water and forests first, to tie it to what Lester has been talking about. One of the most amazing bits of paradigm-busting research done in the 20th century was done by a Brazilian scientist, Inês Salati, who proved unequivocally in the mid-70s that the Amazon makes half of its own rainfall. Before that, the dogma was vegetation is simply the consequence of the climate and it has no influence whatsoever on the climate. Well, that's history, right? If you look at the Amazon through that kind of a lens, it becomes pretty obvious that at a certain point, deforestation will allow that or trigger that hydrological cycle to degrade. And it's pretty close to that tipping point right now, in my view. And of course, nobody wants to find the tipping point by tipping it. It probably contributed to the severe drought in Sao Paulo. Not the only cause, but it probably contributed. So reforestation, in the Amazon region as a way to build back a margin of safety about that hydrological cycle, which actually in the end produces 20% of the world's river water, is a really important thing to do. So the question in all of this is, where does biodiversity fit? And how do you actually recognize some of the value of biodiversity? Well, one of the easiest ways to do it is just through the ecosystem services or the carbon value of a tropical rainforest. But in the end, that's sort of like valuing a computer chip for its silicon. And the real truth here is we don't know enough about the potential of the biological diversity in the Amazon to put any number at all on it, because it's basically a library full of unread books. And occasionally somebody reads one of these books, and then suddenly there is a way to treat hypertension for hundreds of millions of people around the planet. Nobody's ever put a number on that. A horticulturalist, in the mid-19th century gets an idea about how to build a building from looking at the underside of the giant water lily. And that ultimately becomes the basis for his design for the Crystal Palace of 1851 and the origin of modern metal beam architecture like the building we're in. Nobody's ever put a value on that. So I think the great positive about this report is it basically allows that biological diversity to persist and, in essence, you know, maintain the library of the diversity of life for reading centuries and even millennia hence.
Excellent. Thank you, Tom. Lester, shifting back to this question. So you've signaled the warning that the water crisis is perhaps the most imminent crisis that we're facing right now as a human society. Do you see a role that restoration could play? Tom made the link, you know, between with the hydrological cycle between forests and water. Do you see additional links that you'd like to highlight for us?
I see basically the same thing that Tom sees. I mean, when you look at Brazil, and I was noting the deforestation beginning on the coast, and I wondered if they were thinking about Sao Paulo, you know, because if you weaken that cycle, you weaken the amount of water that reaches the interior of the country, and given the patterns of the flows there, it does become important for the southern part of Brazil. One of the things that, this is a bit of an aside, one of the things that I notice with water, and particularly with aquifer depletion, it's not visible. You can't say, oh, look, since last year the aquifers dropped this much, because we're not monitoring it, and we just sort of discover aquifer depletion when the wells go dry, and then we realize that we've been overpumping. And my sort of central concern here is at least 480 million, this is back of the envelope calculation, at least 480 million people in the world are being fed with water from overpumping, 480 million, roughly half a billion. And if that many people are dependent on water from overpumping, what happens when the aquifer is depleted and the wells go dry? I mean, we're kind of out there now and in a risky sort of situation. So that's one of the things we need to be thinking about, and that's going to take us through a whole series of measures on how we can use water more efficiently, and agriculture obviously figures prominently in that, but it's going to be across the board. And, you know, green lawns in California may soon be history. I mean, there just won't be enough water for them. So we're going to have to literally restructure the economy to accommodate the loss of, or the limits on the supply of water we have. Yeah. And we may have to rethink population policy. I mean, with water tables falling and we're still adding 81 million people a year, that may not be a viable set of trends over the long term.
Doesn't sound good.
Walter? Yes, folks, if we could have a quick round of applause for Tom, who needs to run. And if I could please call Walter up to the stage. And if I could also call a special guest, Dr. Lars Lestadius, to join in the fourth seat over here. I mean, something Lester mentioned that I think is quite interesting with aquifer depletion is that we're not monitoring it. And something that I know Lars has placed a lot of his career and his recent work on is in looking at how to monitor both degradation and restoration. And so Lars, thank you for joining us. Lars is a Swedish forester, worked at WRI for more than 15 years. He has his PhD from Virginia Tech University. And Lars, thank you so much for joining as well. And Walter, welcome back to the stage. Paula, we've been talking a lot about water and food systems, and you know, I think part of what I love about restoration is that it actually can generate these economic benefits. And so maybe shifting the discussion back a bit to how important do you think restoration is for rural development in Latin America?
Thank you very much, Sean. Let me try to also connect to the discussion on what I'm an economist, so I don't try to make the connection about restoration and water, although I always understood that's going to really help. But what I want to say in terms of economic benefits, one of the things that for me was very important looking at the report is to, when we look at all these benefits, economic benefits generated by restoration, carbon is important, but it's only whatever, a third or a fourth. All the other values are, all the other 75% is what really counts in restoration. So I imagine that maybe we did not estimate, you did not estimate the water per se, but if we even add the water, it's going to be even higher. And I think that's a message that we that resonates very well also with the country where we're working on. So they are, the restoration is important because of all these other pressing issues that are there. Maybe is the water the most important one, or the food security, or the other one. But that's really the key. And the carbon is important, but it comes as an added element into it. Now back to your question, why is important for rural development? So I was mentioning all these benefits, but I also would like to mention that the World Bank is now really picking this restoration movement, if you want, up and really seriously trying to invest in it, thanks to the LAC 20 by 20 and the partnership we have with WRI and many of our partners, or in Africa, the Africa 100 and the Terra Africa, and et cetera. And what we are seeing is a new interest inside the World Bank and with the client governments for restoration. We just had the Forest and Landscape Action Plan approved in April after many years, that has strong emphasis on landscape restoration as important opportunities for the countries. So, and the way we are seeing it is that this is important, again, as a contribution to the poverty agenda and to the sustainable growth agenda. This kind of reports, this kind of study are really helping us to even make a stronger case for investing in this.
Great, Paula. Is just a follow-up question. Is there anything else that we should be doing, the collective we, all of us in the room that are thinking about this topic, to really try to connect a drive for restoration, you know, with the efforts to generate additional green jobs and to improve rural welfare? What else should we be doing now that we're armed with more numbers and more data?
Yes.
How do we do this?
So what we are seeing, and it's not only for Latin America, but also for our region, is that maybe what is needed are four or five things. So first of all, we need knowledge, and this report is knowledge, is a first attempt. But we don't need only knowledge at this sort of high-level here kind of report, at Wilson Center. We need knowledge also at the local level. When you get down to a farm to do restoration, it's not that obvious. Just to give you an example, and Walter knows that I have a small farm. I'm trying to do not only, you know, to apply what I preach, and when it's difficult. It's very difficult.
It's not easy.
So you need a lot of extension services. We need to invest in that. It seems very nice. I have access to all the reports that the farmers don't, and when you're there, you say, oh, shall I prune this tree this way or this other way? Am I doing it in the right week, or should I wait next week? I mean, so we need knowledge, general knowledge to move things, but we need also local knowledge, invest in the local parts. Of course, we need investment, but I think there you saw the financial architecture of LAC 20 by 20. I think we're getting there. The money is going to flow. We need partnership, and again, I think we are really moving a partnership. We maybe need to have partnership now also at the local level again, because in a landscape approach, in a landscape restoration, you cannot do it only with one farmer. You need the local government, you need the extension, you need the local private sector to bring able to bring the products that now you generate and sell them, help the farmer to sell them in markets, etc. So you need to create partnership also at the local level. And then I think you need a passion. It's like a passion, you need champions. It's like a new movements that we are creating. And I think that, you know, inside the World Bank, I'm definitely sort of championing that, but I'm not alone. I'm actually, my director, Julia Bucknell, is very passionate. Laura Tack, our vice president for sustainable development, is part of the Global Restoration Council. So everybody has a role, and you need local champions, of course, which are the ones that everybody is going to somewhat imitate, if you want. So I think these are four important elements, and to do more.
Excellent, Paula. Thank you so much. Lester, back to you. Would you agree with those four things that Paula put forward? Certainly you've embodied many of those over the years. Are there others or ones that you would underscore in that list?
It's been a long time since I've been in the Washington bureaucracy, but it's sounding good to me.
great. Thanks, Lester. So folks in the audience, I'm gonna pose one additional question to Lars. And then we'd like to turn to you to hear what questions that you may have for the panelists. So while I know you'll be listening very closely to Lars, be thinking about the questions that you would like to pose to the panel as well. Lars, you've been working in this space for quite some time. Two questions to you. Can these losses in natural capital, can they be monetized through restoration? And as Lester mentioned, with aquifer depletion, we're not monitoring that very closely. There are other types of degradation we're not monitoring very closely. We're also not monitoring restoration very closely. I'd love to get your thoughts on the monitoring aspects of this as well, if we could.
Thank you, Sean. What is fascinating to me, I think, is the difficulty of seeing properly the degradation here. Part of it is that it is it's far away, it's removed by distance. And you may not see it because out of sight is out of mind somehow. The other reason is that much of it happened in the past and you don't see it because it's a few generations before your own life. And you tend to accept that the way that was when you grew up, that's the way it's supposed to be. This is your reference. And anything that is outside of that and earlier than that, you don't see. But looking at this report, and this is based on simulations that we made, about one-fifth of the forests in this continent have been completely converted, lost, if you will. And another fifth of the forests are degraded, meaning that they're much less than they should be. And one-fifth of this continent is about the size of India. We're talking very large areas here. So this means that you have a dislocation. You know, the carbon has been dislocated out of these systems. Soil particles have been dislocated out of these systems. The water is no longer kept in these systems. Nutrients have disappeared out of these systems. So you have direct side effects of that. You also have opportunity costs that things that don't happen because these lands are depleted, they are functioning much under their potential. So can you monetize that? Can you measure it first of all? Difficult. Can you monetize it? Also difficult, I think, because the whoever is investing would probably want to see the return flow back to them instead of to the general. So it suggests a role here for the public sector to support where the original investor cannot monetize the full value. But another thing you need to do is to monetize is actually to measure. And on the measurement side, we have good news because there's new technology appearing and will appear that is going to drastically improve our ability to measure these stocks and these flows. I remember the old mainframe era where if you wanted to have access to the computer, you have to sign a form and file it with the men in white coats that were guarding the big and holy computer, right? And maybe you got access for 15 minutes of the time. Then the PC came and the technology sort of escaped out of the control of these people. A solution without a problem, as they said. But look at it now. And that means that, and then this process is continuing. So we are going to be able to have individual people make observations, collect information, I think, in ways that we could not dream of and possibly still cannot dream of. This technology is getting cheaper by the day, better by the day, easier to use by the day. And there is, just like this book that we may not yet have opened, that's another book that is waiting to be opened that I believe is going to help us to monetize some of these things in ways that we have not even imagined yet.
Wonderful. Yes, Lester, you want to add to that?
I just wanted to mention on the, been talking about marketing. The question is often raised, why don't we have a water market? The answer is we do have one. It's called the World Grain Market. Hmm. It takes 1,000 tons of water to produce a ton of grain, so why move the water around? Hmm. This is an issue that's kind of, the market has sorted out on its own. Another thing I wanted to mention is the political disruption that can occur when the resource base, the natural resource base, begins to break down. I don't know how many of you have been following it, but you may know that China is in the process of moving 150 million people from the western part of the country, the arid part of the country, to the east. I mean, that's almost half the population of the United States. It's a huge thing, but the water is going. It's largely gone there, and they have to relocate huge numbers of people. We're seeing the same thing happen in Africa, in West Africa, south of the Sahel. As the desert keeps moving south, people are getting squeezed, and a UN number estimated that probably 50 million people will have to move to North Africa or to Europe or maybe someplace else. But these are large movements of people that are now beginning to show up, but I think it's only the beginning. The number of people being replaced, the number of water migrants we see, the number of desertification migrants that we see. It's been interesting to watch the Chinese government deal with desertification. It's moving from west to east, and they really can't reverse that. I mean, they can't even stop it in some places, and so they're really really suffering as they try to adjust to this, these new forces at work here. One of the other things, and we've touched on this, is the role of information. We need to know what is happening if we're going to respond intelligently to it. And as I look, particularly at the water issue, and look around the world, I don't see many national political leaders that are even thinking about it or even recognize it as an issue. But I can say with some confidence that in the years immediately ahead, it is going to be a major issue. And it suddenly becomes a political issue, particularly when you have shared rivers between countries, for example. And aquifers are also shared in many parts of the world. So it's a problem you can't see. But it's clearly there, and it's clearly going to be an issue. And when I'm asked, you know, which is more imminent, you know, water scarcity or climate change, for me, it's clearly water scarcity. It is here now. I mean, displacing 150 million people in China is huge. I mean, we couldn't have imagined this a few years ago, that we'd see this mass movement of people because Western China is simply drying out. So it's an educational challenge to begin with so few people having an understanding of this problem, partly because a large part of the problem is aquifer depletion and you can't see it. You can photograph deforestation. You can see where the trees were and where they aren't, but you can't do that with aquifers. So we've got to move ahead on the scientific and information front, getting information out so that people who are making decisions, whether as consumers or as policymakers at the institutional level, can respond to it. So I see it as an enormous challenge, and one with a real sense of urgency. When water tables are falling as fast as they are in important parts of the world, we need to be doing something fairly substantial and quickly. I don't see it happening very much anywhere yet.
Great. Thank you, Lester. So, folks, you've heard an urgent call to action that we need improved scientific information. We need that information to be in the hands of decision makers. These things are urgent. There are many of these connections that we need to make. I'm curious to hear what questions, what thoughts you may have for our esteemed panelists. And is there a microphone? Terrific. So we start with the young lady right here. Yes, right, sure. Right beside you. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Cindy Arnson, the director of the Latin American program here at the Wilson Center. Thank you all for this very enlightening and important discussion, and I'm delighted to be called a young lady, so thank you for that as well. My question, I think, is probably mostly for Walter, but potentially for the other panelists. You talked about the increased agricultural production in Latin America as a percentage of the global food supply. That implies to me an increase in agribusiness and very large-scale agricultural production. So when you talk about landscape restoration in Latin America, are you referring, or how much are you referring to small farms, medium farms, large-scale farms, which have vastly increased productivity, but in certain cases, in the Pampas in Argentina and other places, have contributed to some of these other difficulties that other panelists have addressed, including overuse of pesticides and depletion of the water table. So landscape restoration, yes, but it seems to me what kind very much matters, and I was wondering if you could address that.
Great. And Walter, if you could hold that just for 1 second. Why don't we take three questions, and then we'll have our panelists respond. I think this gentleman here was the second to have his hand up. Back in the blue shirt. Yes.
Jordan Sellers. I'm with FJS Helter Skelter Politics and Social Science. My question was, I think there is a need for creating like a more perfect union, and I wanted to know specifically if there was something that could be done in terms of, I guess my question essentially is whether or not the problem with the restoration that you want to do, is that contributed to a food desert, and what could be done from a diplomatic perspective from other countries getting in on what they're trying to do in Latin America, particularly the U.S. agenda, and providing some type of aid with whatever they're trying to do as far as restoration in Latin America. So the question in a nutshell, there are food deserts probably in Latin America, and what can other countries do to partner in terms of some type of assistance or diplomatic aid?
Okay, thank you. And I think this gentleman here in the sweater, yes, thank you.
Yeah, I'm John Strand. I'm currently in the Inter-American Development Bank. I wasn't until recently in the World Bank, and I was heading a project there in the research department on the spatial valuation of the Amazon rainforest, and that is still going on. I just want to tie in something from that here, because we've done a study of hydrological impacts of deforestation, and we found very interesting impacts on the outputs for for soybeans and cattle in Brazil and Argentina, and also on hydropower production, so that there's a rather substantial impacts from deforestation on the hydrological cycle through those channels. I had another comment, namely that there was the issue of what does carbon mean here, and it seems that the value you put on carbon is rather low, on the low side. If you upped it to, say, $25 a ton, which is a more standard value, I think that would take over a much larger share of the overall valuation in your project. But it seems now that it's rather low. But I've done other research finding that you could easily have that, what you call willingness to pay, which you don't want to talk about, if you look at it globally, then that could really matter equally much in terms of, say, biodiversity, how that's valued globally.
Great.
And I had another question. One question was on looking at, say, a country like Brazil, which does not play that a big role. I see you see all the Mato Grosso in your model here. But I know that in Brazil, there's a lot of degraded land that could, in principle, be transformed to high-level productivity agriculture. And then the question is, I haven't read the report carefully, but are your benefits here mostly in terms of the land itself, or in terms of avoiding future deforestation? Because if you could transform that to high-level agriculture, you could expand that without cutting down more forest. And that would be a very important part of the benefits here.
Great. Thank you, sir. All right. So why don't we start with the question around small, medium, large-scale agriculture. Walter, for you to start, and then if those are interested, please.
My young Cynthia. Very good question. Look, in the restoration definition, we're talking about mixed landscapes, agriculture combined with forestry, and cattle ranching combined with forestry, but also low-carbon agriculture. And we have excluded large agribusiness practices that have a very significant and negative environmental impact associated with all the inputs that it uses, including pesticides, herbicides, water. You can also think about cattle ranching as extensive cattle ranching as not sustainable. So the countries, which are the ones that have offered the definition, have rightfully so excluded unsustainable practices in agriculture and forestry. But let me give you an example, a real example. One of the investors in 20 by 20 is investing in a large operation in Mato Grosso called Novo Campo. And right there is one head of cattle per hectare. Over time, it was bigger before, the density was higher, but over time, the cattle density has been decreasing and the amount of production from that land has been dropping. What this investor is doing is bringing a technological package that will reforest part of that land, therefore reducing the temperature of the soil, enabling that area to retain more water through the root systems of the forest, increasing directly the yields of dairy cattle and other meat products because the animals don't have to suffer so much heat and so much stress. They benefit from the shade of the trees. Reforesting the riparian areas, increasing the quality of the pastures. As a result of that, this group is investing a total of $100 million, not necessarily with low area farmers. These are middle-sized farmers in the countries of Brazil. But the result of that is a series of benefits. Increased cattle production and dairy products, some income from timber operations in the long term, better soil conservation, some returning biodiversity, and very important, it's tied to the question by John, they think that they are avoiding the deforestation of 60,000 hectares. Now, how do they monetize that? Very difficult to do, or at least they haven't found a formula for that, but they have included that in their balance sheet. Our corporate responsibility, well, we get this rate of return. In addition, we're avoiding deforestation of 60,000 hectares. So that's an example And a long way to answer your question, non-sustainable agricultural practices clearly are not part of the restoration cycle.
Great. Paula, please. Yeah.
Thank you very much, and thank you for the questions. I just want to mention that the World Bank, when we work on landscape restoration, we, of course, our main initial focus is going to be the small farmers, but we also, as Walter was also saying, we are also trying to get to the middle farmers. For example, in Latin America, we are designing a very big program in the Orinoquia in Colombia, where we are going to have big farmers being part of that, and with very important commodities, and we're trying to really make it low carbon and more environmentally friendly. Or in Paraguay, just this morning I was discussing a new proposal for working on landscape restoration in Paraguay, which I hope soon will join also the LAC 20 by 20. And again, that is there, it's a mix, working with the small farmers and with the big farmers. In Africa, we are doing a lot of landscape restoration. There, the focus is mainly the small farmer at the moment. And we are actually one of the, I didn't answer before, how does this bring jobs? We are really trying in Africa, in Rwanda, in Burundi, in Kenya, to make sure that the landscape restoration is actually paid as a sort of cash for work program, as an initial immediate measure of getting some immediate benefits, given that the other benefits will come in a couple of years, maybe. And once these other benefits come, I hope that we will stop looking at the crops individually as in a value chain kind of giving value only on a vertical value chain, but look at really at the landscape and the territory and see how we improve the value of the entire landscape, and that will bring a lot of economic benefits related maybe to tourism or to putting things in a circuit and on a horizontal kind of competitiveness and not only vertical, and I think that will increase the shared prosperity of the territory.
Great, thank you, Paula. Lester.
One of the things that has occurred to me during this discussion is that maybe when we're thinking about land use, for example, we should be thinking also about policy changes in remote parts of the world that can affect land use, in this case in Latin America. I think, for example, of China. China, since the Great Famine of 1959-61, when 37 million people starved to death, they have wanted to be grain self-sufficient, which they define as 95% self-sufficiency, every year. They politically do not feel that they can take a chance on going below that. And one of the consequences of that has been that soybean production in China today is the same as it was 50 years ago. Mm. It hasn't increased at all. Grain production has. But this has affected agriculture in the New World very directly. 62% of all the soybeans that go into the world trade now go to China. And the big producers are the U.S., Brazil, and Argentina. So this decision in China has led to a restructuring of agriculture in the Western Hemisphere. In the United States, for example, we now have far more land in soybeans than we do either corn or wheat. Historically, corn and wheat totally dominated. Soybeans were kind of a fringe crop. Today, soybeans are the big crop, and corn and wheat are secondary. But I mention that because that was not part of U.S. long-term agricultural planning, but it's something that happened. And this desire to be self-sufficient in grain in China means that most of the soybeans in the world are being produced in the U.S., Brazil, and Argentina. In fact, 85% of the world's soybean crop is produced in these three countries. And it's not because we set out a long time ago and said we want to do this. It's because we're responding to economic conditions that are driven by political policy decisions in some cases. And it leads to a much more complex sort of analytical challenge when you have to fit these together, and they're difficult to anticipate sometimes.
Great, thank you, Lester. Well, picking up that topic of interdependence, young man had a question, putting forward a vision of a more perfect union, which I think everyone in this country and this world is looking for. This question around food deserts in Latin America, and how can other countries, other external actors play a productive role in helping in the food desert situation or in restoration more broadly? Anyone want to take that? Paula, you want to kick us off?
Let me try to say a little bit what the World Bank is trying to bring. We are also in a discussion with the European Union has a very interesting policy called the cultural landscape policy. So we are trying to bring that element, which is not an economic element. It's really to say, you know, in a desert, how did you call it, a desert landscape, a desert food landscape with only one mono crop, versus a polyculture. It has not only economic reasons on why you should actually prefer a polyculture, but there are also cultural heritage and many other reasons. And this kind of discussion resonates a lot when you talk even to farmers in Africa or in India. They understand what the heritage landscape is, and that's what they actually aspire in some sense. So our role is now to bring the economic argument, but also some other argument. And that's why when I was talking to you about the passion that you need to bring, it's an important complement to all these other economic argument. And I think when my colleague was talking about the willingness to pay that you decided not to use, I'm a big believer in the willingness to pay. I actually, many years ago when I did my PhD, I did it with a professor called Richard Carson, one of the first to use the willingness to pay methodology for a big disaster of Exxon Valdez. So that tries to capture all these non-tangible benefits. But we are moving also on this part to really avoid this food desert syndrome that you have, and that has a lot of our negative consequences, not only on the environment but on the culture, on the heritage, on the psychology of the people, on the well-being, if you want. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Paula. Any others for that question? If not, Walter, I guess three questions for you, perhaps. Number one, why $5 a ton for carbon? on the lower side. Second, a couple of people have mentioned willingness to pay as a very interesting dynamic that was left out of this study. And then the third is, it was mentioned in the Brazil context, but I think it's valid for the region, is avoided degradation part of the economic equation here? Or is it only looking at the restoration?
Very good questions. And they come probably from economists, all of them. My economist is sitting down there, but I'll try to do my best. Okay, $5 per carbon. Clearly, it's not what carbon is worth. You know that the projection by IFC for this year, for next year market, medium-term market, which is 5 to 7 years, they are placing it at 25. It's an exercise into the future. Lord Stern, some years ago, estimated $100 per ton, and then he revised the number and said, this is an underestimate, should be higher. Mm-hmm. So clearly, the intrinsic value is much higher. But we are doing this exercise thinking about the private sector today, and the voluntary market is around that value. So the report does make the point that this is the bottom line that is undervalued, but that's the number that is used. But we do show a sensitivity analysis, and clearly the results are exactly what you pointed out, no? If we put a a good value in carbon, it will drive restoration significantly. And that's one conclusion. Climate is related to restoration. There are intrinsic linkages between the two issues, and value in the market at the right price will have a great influence on restoration. Now, on willingness to pay, I remember, no, I agree, I not disagree with economists on this, but I remember a graph when I was at the World Bank, a graph that we were drawing on the investment made on the restoration, on the conservation of condor populations. The condor, the big, it was almost extinct in the 1970s, is still vulnerable. But all over the Andes, the populations were dropping. So how much money was invested in conserving the habitat required for the condor or protecting the condor population? Well, in the 1950s, zero. In the 1960s, marginal. A few biologists got a few grants in Colombia and in California and put a little bit of money. Then in the 1970s, when someone said there are only 21 condors left in California, the number went up. Can we wait until the populations of our companions in this planet are on the brink of extinction to value the populations? No, we can't, clearly. So if we do willingness to pay in the 1950s, oh no, let the condor go. 1960s, it's not important. Only when there were 21 left, they would put a serious value on it. And you can repeat that graph for other populations. I've seen the population for the this monkey in the Mata Atlantica. I don't remember the name right now. But only when the population, what's the name? The golden lion. Only when the population was a few hundred pairs of golden lion monkeys, did the Smithsonian and the National Zoos and the entire scientific community said, we are going to rescue it, and it cost hundreds of millions of dollars to bring it back. It would have been much easier in the 1940s to protect the habitat for that. So that's what is behind our difficulty and willingness to pay. If you ask the people around the blue parrot, they'll say, blue parrot, yeah, there were a few years ago, there is only one now, but who cares about blue parrot? But if you ask the people at the Genetic Institute of the University of Sao Paulo, they say, we cannot allow this blue parrot to disappear. But are they interviewed for willingness to pay? Normally, no. So that's my problem. Now, on avoided degradation, clearly, big benefit from restoration projects. Look, as Paola and Lester and Tom before that have said, this is a tremendous problem for us. We are destroying our natural ecosystems at a record pace. I bring back the 3.4 million hectares deforested in 2014, 70% of the area of Costa Rica. And imagine all the animals, all the plants, all the insects, all the butterflies, all the birds that went in the smoke with that. So clearly we have to make efforts to avoid the continuing spoiling of our natural capital. But how can we do that? How can we value that? John, help us put a number on it.
Great, thank you, Walter. Mm-hmm. Let's take three more questions, please. So the first three hands I saw up were here in the blue shirt, this gentleman here with a leather jacket, and this young lady in the purple sweater.
Hi, I'm Robin Chasden from World Resources Institute. This is mostly for Walter or Paolo, but others may want to comment. It's really on the ground, it's the farmers that are the stewards and champions of restoration into the future. So how do you envision the investments that you were describing today actually reaching the farmers whose land is being restored, or will the immediate benefits of restoration on their farms be sufficient to allow them to replace existing land uses? So what do you see as the most effective channels of these investments to reach the farmers?
Thank you. My name is Raul Toisin. I was with the Inter-American Development Bank, doing other things now. My question is for all the panelists, but perhaps Paola and Walter as well, And I'd like to try to tie together a couple of things. I think the comment on local action is really pertinent, because in the end, who implements policy, whether it's forest policy or land policy, is the farmer, the hand that holds the axe. And working in local partnerships is the way to go, because we have to do something on the ground. Now, we've had a lot of experience over the decades of how to do things. And Paola mentioned something very interesting in your work in Africa, cash for work. It's not the first time this idea has come by. We've tried since early on in Latin America, certainly food for work programs. We've had other experiments with cash vouchers for farmers and what to do. And one of the things is we've tried them and we've moved on to something else. And we don't know if they really worked, or we don't know why we stopped. Lester mentioned the importance of the need for information of what's going on. And certainly we need information about what's going on in the aquifers, but I think maybe we need information about how people on the ground, the farmers, the agriculturalists, are actually responding. What role do you see in terms of moving our research interests to a very applied way of research in impact evaluation and studies? Do we see, how much are you building that into this work and the great work that's been done in the social sectors about responses into our work in natural resources that has a high degree of publicness to that work? Great. Are we doing any sort of that kind of applied research? Great. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Hi, I'm Sasha Gottlieb from the U.S. Forest Service International Programs Office. And it's interesting, these three questions, mine also, are all focused more on implementation, I think. So I'm curious, and this is for all of you up there, you know, I look at the 20 by 20 and I look at the economic case, which is clear, but what are the barriers now for moving to the next step, and how do we overcome those barriers? How do we work with countries to overcome them, or communities to overcome them?
Great, yes, three very related questions, I think. You know, how does investment reach farmers? How do we make sure that our research is applied and that we're learning from what's been done in the past? And what are the barriers to implementation? Paula, you ready to kick us off? All right.
Let me go first. Okay, thank you very much. Our focus is now really on how to bring this at the local level. We have programs starting, in some sense, mushrooming, if you want, blooming, maybe it's a better word, everywhere in Latin America, in Africa, in Asia, that have a landscape restoration title, or you know. So now we need to bring it down to the local level to make sure these things happen. And the focus, what we see is that the focus really needs to be, first of all, on technical assistance to the farmers. You need to bring the knowledge. You need to bring, once we have convinced the governments to get a loan and do that, then you need to bring the knowledge to the farmers. And we are using all methods that you already know. I mean, I was just coming back 2 weeks ago from Burundi, very, very difficult countries, and we will need to use farmer field schools to really bring this knowledge to the local level, because the government doesn't have extension services as yet to really pick this up. So we are really reinforcing all our work at the farmer field with farmer field schools in partnership with FAO, with World Vision, and with others. So that's one important element. We are, and the same things we are doing in Latin America, we are now starting a program in Nicaragua on the dryland corridors, and I'm very sad to see that the drylands area are, of course, the most difficult one to show economic benefits. So there are other benefits anyway. We cannot abandon these areas. We need to invest for other social reasons in these areas. We are not China that can move 150 million people, you know, from one region to the next. So, again, we are going to make sure. I think that the most important barrier that we have seen also in Latin America is actually knowledge. One of my colleagues, Stefano Pagiola, who has been one of the first one to do impact evaluation work, he has shown that actually at the end of the day, what was most relevant for the adoption of landscape restoration was not the money or the investment or the payment of environmental services, but was actually the technical assistance. The technical assistance was really the key one. And I would like also to respond in general on the impact evaluation. Our sector, the environment and natural resource and agriculture, have not used enough the impact evaluation tools inside the World Bank. Our colleagues from DEC are now reaching out to us to say, you need to have it more. We are trying. We are in all our new key programs, we are adding the impact evaluation. It's not easy. Again, going back to my example from Burundi, we are going to work on a certain number. I don't know how many of you know Burundi. It's a very hilly country. It's not very different from the Andes in some sense. Small pieces of land, half an hectare, where people need to live, very degraded. So if we choose to work with a certain group, how do we find the control? It's not a trivial question. We've been really struggling because, I mean, one hill is different from another, so you can never find the exact control. But I had the impact evaluation expert with me because we want to show this result. It's key if we want to continue in this restoration movement. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Paula. Lars, and then Tilas.
Well, the question of barriers is interesting. I think the biggest barrier is habit. Restoration is clearly not business as usual, because we had that business as usual for decades or centuries, and what we need is something completely different. And that means that the representatives of business as usual are not necessarily the change agents here. Governments and institutions come to mind. You know, they are inert, and inertia and habit is sort of the opposite of what we need now, which makes me think of the more nimble players, small farmers or whatnot, as very hopeful agents in here. They will more easily change their behavior, I think, than the big institutions that are very inert. So that is the question, then how would you bring resources and incentives to these small farmers? Well, one of the good things here, and we are now talking restoration at scale, which is many, many millions of hectares. I doubt very much that you can do this on a project basis with thousands of dollars invested per hectare. The investment is going to be too great. Fortunately, this is not needed. Some of this work can be done by small farmers at very low financial cost, I believe. And we have seen this certainly in Africa in what they call farmer-managed natural regeneration. Basically, the essence of this is that you work with Mother Nature instead of against Mother Nature. You learn to see the tree as the friend instead of seeing the tree as the enemy, mm-hmm. right? And if you do that right, you can, through many, many small points of green, achieve effect at low financial cost across a very large landscape. Finally, in terms of the project evaluation rule, that I don't believe in projects. I believe, however, that out of sight, out of mind, seeing is doing, and the new technology, information communications technology, the essence of what it does is that it allows us to see. It allows us to see in a distance, it allows us to see underground, it allows us to see the things we need to see. And as we see the things we need to see, we will begin to act differently. And that will be ubiquitous. And this is, to me, my biggest hope. Thank you.
Great, Lars. Thank you very much. Lester, to you.
One thing that has occurred to me as we've been talking is that the world market for grains, soybeans, whatever, is changing. Throughout our lifetimes, there's been competition between exporting countries. There are signs that that's beginning to change, because some of the countries that are fairly heavy exporters, the U.S. being one, is doing it in part by depleting aquifers. And maybe the U.S. will decide it really doesn't want to deplete its aquifers. And it begins restricting exports in order to avoid that. I mention that because it's a total departure from the world grain market we've known during our lifetimes. There's always been competition among the exporters, but some of the exporters may not want to be that competitive anymore because of what's happening to their underground water resources. So I mention that because the whole milieu in which we operate may be changing in some fairly fundamental ways.
Oh, very exciting. Walter.
Yes, excellent question, Sasha. listen, I'll answer your question in the context of the initiative. The restoration movement is much larger than the initiative. But we've been looking at the barriers there very carefully. And I can give you a list of them. There are some financial barriers. Lack of working capital, I mentioned that. Lack of upfront money to develop the portfolio of projects. Ability to reduce the risk of investment. All of those are in the category of financial. But there is also a social barrier, and it's the title of land. In order to be able to work with farmers, they need to show ownership. And in some countries in Latin America, it's difficult, to say the least. The incentives issue, fiscal and regulatory incentives for land restoration, is also an important barrier. And we are doing an exercise, hopefully it will be published next year, comparing the state of the art of incentives for restoration in Latin America, what is being done, what has been tried and has failed, and what gaps exist, and how can we offer a basket of incentive instruments that could be shown to be effective. There is another barrier that is very serious, is the lack of vegetation material. We're talking about native trees, bringing back native trees or bushes or ornamental plants. And in many cases, we're talking about 20 million hectares. Where will you get that material? No? So you have to ramp up the process of producing this germoplasm. And that's a major barrier. And we're looking at that also. And finally, monitoring. It's a significant barrier, and Lars has spoken about it. I won't extend on it, but being able to see what's happening or not being able to see what's happening is a significant barrier, needs to be addressed. Robin, very quickly, very good question also. The champions of restoration are clearly, the first champions of restoration are clearly the front line, the farmers, the owners of the land. So also in the context of 20 by 20, we are not, the fellows that are bringing money to 20 by 20 are not the big Wall Street firms, Goldman Sachs. We're not talking about Goldman Sachs. We're talking about impact investors. So they have a different modus operandi, business model. And it's different for each one of them, but in many cases, these folks are interested in creating social capital. So that's an important element for being part of 20 by 20. How do you reflect that development of social capital? Well, in the case of one investor, what they want is to be able to constitute new companies whose ownership is based on the local communities. That's fantastic. Others want to not form new companies, but take whatever it is there and expand it and make it better and strengthen the business model. So that's another structure. There are other impact investors that want to acquire the land. So I don't want to trick you. There exists that also in the business model of the impact investors. But we are, in general, talking about folks that have a social motivation as well as a financial motivation.
Wonderful. Thank you, Walter. Well, so first I want to apologize to anyone whose question we did not get to during the discussion. I encourage everyone to come up and continue the discussion with the panelists. I think this was a great discussion. You know, for me, for my personal takeaways was that, you know, we do need better information, we need better knowledge, which is precisely what this report is trying to do. In an effort to try to recognize the urgency of the situation that we're seeing from a water perspective, from a climate perspective, from a biodiversity perspective and others. Hopefully this will help us form new habits, better habits as human society and as individuals. We need new agents that are activated on this agenda. And I think, you know, Paula, you mentioned this a number of times, just the passion and what I might say the courage, I think, for us to be able to move this forward. And when I was reflecting on why the five panelists, including Tom, who had to leave, why they are my favorite people, and they're people that I really admire in this sector, is because they have courage. They've taken extraordinary measures to put the right thing on the right agenda at the right time. And I think all of us, including myself, we need to reflect on ways that we can try to embody that kind of courage and passion as well. So if I could have a round of applause for our panelists. And why don't we stay seated for a moment? I'd like to turn it over to Paolo to close this out.
Sean, can I just add one point? I would like to challenge people on something that is in my mind. Can we do something like a movement or an activity, I don't know what it's called, which is adopt a landscape, restore a landscape. You know, like you have adopt a road? Can we do that and all together and multiply these seeds in the mind of people who maybe are far away but are willing to play to adopt the landscape? Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I'd like to tell you a brief story and make an announcement, something that I'm sure that you want to be present here on November the 15th, which is, by the way, Republic Day in Brazil. But we have an important event directly related to this. The story is that about 9 years ago, 1 year after I joined the Wilson Center, a guy by the name Blairo Maggi, then governor of the state of Mato Grosso, was in Washington, and at that time he had just few weeks before that, or a couple of years before that actually, Greenpeace, as only Greenpeace can do, had given him the Golden Chainsaw Award. He's a major soybean producer. His family produces about 7% of the world's soybean. And Blairo was pretty mad. I told him, Governor, you have to come to the Wilson Center. We have to talk. I will invite all the environmentalists because you have to talk to them. He said, I'm not going to talk to these people because they gave me this award and this is, I'll say, Governor, trust me. I convinced him, the environmentalists came, Tom Lovejoy helped a lot, and others. Just, 3 months ago, we had a meeting at the Nature Conservancy. Now, currently, Minister of Agriculture, Blairo Maggi, was there. He is also a senator in Brazil. Very influential politician. His family continues to grow, 7 to 10% of the world's soybean. And someone from the Greenpeace said, Minister, I'm from Greenpeace, and everybody knowing the story. And Blairo Maggi made a comment that was very interesting. He said, guys, I was pretty frustrated when you did that to me. But let me tell you, we all learned. When I got home that evening, my two adolescent daughters asked me, Dad, what are you doing? Because the daughters obviously sympathize with Greenpeace. There has been a dialogue in Brazil over this. And this is where I come to the November 15th. We are going to host here a group of Brazilian, very influential people in the agricultural sector, including two former ministers of agriculture. One of them, Alisson Paulinelli, who started actually Embrapa, the Federal Research Agricultural Company, Roberto Rodriguez, people from the University of São Paulo Agricultural School, from where Enea Salati, mentioned by Tom Lovejoy, came from and formed generations of agronomists, as we call them in Brazil. So they will be actually in the morning at the World Bank, in a closed door session to talk about agriculture and sustainability in Brazil. The message has been received in Brazil that in order to fulfill this role, there is only one way politically to do it, is to embrace sustainability. So they will go in the morning there to the World Bank, and Paula and your colleagues there will probably tell them, challenge them very much. And then they will come here to the Wilson Center for a public session. And we'll try to keep it small to make it really a conversation. So please, if you want to participate, leave your card with us. We'll send you an invitation. This is going to take place in November the 15th, probably in the early afternoon. But you are all welcome. And it's important that you engage with the producers in Brazil about this question. With that, I would like to thank you very much for being here. Thank you, the World Resources Institute, Walter, Luciana, Helen, Sean, especially Lester and Paola, and also our Tom. And stay tuned, because we will stay on this subject, and we hope that this is one of many discussions of the type. Thank you very much.